Talk Bomb.
Book Club Shmook Club is brought to you by TalkBomb.com. It's a book review show where at Chill and Kristen and her brother at Will Rogers 2000 talk about books and whatever else they want. Subscribe on iTunes, Stitcher, or wherever you typically get your podcasts. Hello, welcome to Book Club Shmook Club. I'm Kristen.
I'm William.
And we are here to talk to you about the book PENPAL by Dathan Auerbach.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is a weird one.
Yeah, totally.
And I'm very excited to talk to you about it. This
Me
is a book.
Me too, William.
That, oh, that's so nice.
Oh,
we're so nice. Hey, shout out. This is both an audio and a video show. So you can either listen on iTunes, Stitcher, or wherever, or go to youtube.com/WB2045 and watch us do this. But yeah, this is a book that I have had on my mind probably since
on
we started.
On your mind grapes?
Yeah, it's been on my mind grapes, little lemon. probably since we started the show that I wanted to eventually talk about this book because it's such a weird case.
Yeah.
It's such – it's.
Yeah, I didn't look up a lot of stuff about it because I wanted you to tell me about it.
Yeah, it's very different from any book that we've ever read before. And as a matter of fact, I think it's a very different book from – historically what books are like.
Yeah, sounds like it.
You know, do you have a spoiler-free plot synopsis?
Yeah, it's like two sentences long.
Okay, cool. Because I want to just get that out of the way before we even say anything about it, because this is
seriously.
A cool... Okay.
Yeah.
That works.
Because even the description on Amazon is like nothing, basically.
Yeah, they keep it very intentionally vague.
It's a sentence. PENPAL is a book of short, creepy stories about adolescence and friendship united by a theme of creepiness. Are you scared yet?
Oh, that's... Wow. All right, that is...
Told you.
That is a lot less than I was expecting. So PENPAL started out on, you know, Reddit.
Yes.
So Reddit is a... there are, like... You can have your own pages called subreddits, which are particular like websites themed to topics. Anybody can post whatever they want. There's one called NoSleep.
Yeah.
It's especially very popular
now.
Oh,
damn. Oh, shit.
What?
So it's not a creepypasta.
It is a creepypasta.
Because there's a joke I have in my summary that hinges on the fact that it's a creepypasta.
It is a creepypasta. Phew. So creepypastas are scary stories.
Yeah.
They're urban legends just written now in the age of the internet.
Mm-hmm.
And it's literally, I think it started as there used to be things that people would copy and paste all the time.
Yeah.
And then over time, somehow that turned into people calling those copy pastas.
Mm-hmm.
You would copy and paste it so that here's another copy pasta for you. And then when these
so
like.
Good, so stupid.
And then when people started writing scary stories on the internet and they'd get passed around a lot. And there's some really famous ones.
Yeah.
Those started being called creepypastas.
Uh-huh.
So that's the origin of the term.
Gotcha. I had no idea where it came from.
Yeah, I didn't know that for a very long time.
I just had my own creepypasta. Molly just went under my chair and like kind of pressed up on it, so I felt pressure coming up on my butt, which is not usually the way that goes.
She was probably trying to like scratch her back on the underside of the chair.
Definitely what she was doing.
It's funny. The dog's napping in the other room, but it's like, oh, I have an itch. I need to go scratch my back. So this NoSleep subreddit is specifically themed for scary stories.
Yeah.
Now I took a bunch of notes because I like this story quite a bit.
Yeah.
I think it's really interesting and I wanted to see like really where it started because it's a 6-part story basically.
Yeah.
Each chapter of the book that we read, is, a short contained story that originally appeared on the NoSleep subreddit. So I looked this up. The first time anything was posted by Dathan Auerbach under the name 1000 Vultures was the story Footsteps. They're in the same order. The chapters that we read in the book that we read are the same order and largely the same events as what he wrote on the NoSleep subreddit. But he posted it in September 2011.
Okay.
And essentially, over the course of like just under a month, he posted all 6 of these.
Cool.
Which is amazing to
me. That's awesome.
Like I got here late.
Yeah.
I should say. I found out about PENPAL after the book had already been published.
Mm-hmm.
So by the time that I stumbled across the first story, chapter 1 of this book called Footsteps, I was like, wow, this is incredible.
Yeah.
And there are references in the post to being like, I may write more.
Mm-hmm.
And you can look and you're, and I was like, oh my God, there is more.
Yeah.
And I read the next one and it's like, okay, for the next story, click here. I was like, oh my God, so how long has this been going?
Yeah.
And then the final story ends with him going, I think I'm going to start a Kickstarter to publish this as a book.
Yeah.
And I click on that link and go to Kickstarter where it's been completely
funded. Already a book. Yeah.
And fantastic. So I was like, oh my God, all right, I got here so late that I get to have this.
Yeah.
I just get the whole thing.
Perfect time to come in, honestly.
Yes, absolutely. That's awesome. I got to like binge read the whole thing. So I read all the short stories online and then I bought the book and I read the book. But I never really knew how it unfolded.
Right.
So I had a very interesting experience in this past week trying to, because the internet is an archive.
Yeah.
You can literally go back and read the original story and see what people commented.
I know, that's really cool.
After he wrote each segment of this story of what eventually became the book PenPal.
Yeah.
And so it was really kind of cool.
Mm-hmm.
At a certain point, I think it was after, yeah, I have it here. After he wrote the third story, which became chapter three, Boxes, in the comments, somebody asks him about the woods. Mm-hmm. There's like a big thing about living in kind of a rural area where there are a lot of woods that are in your backyard.
Mm-hmm.
And so somebody asked him in the comments to talk more about what the woods were like. And he started to talk about how he and his buddy Josh in the story used to raft through the creek on styrofoam that they had turned into rafts. I couldn't picture that.
Me neither. I was having a hard time with that.
I had no idea.
Yeah.
But then suddenly he stops talking about like what he used to do and he goes, actually, that just made me remember something.
Oh, cool.
And then just a few days later, he posted the next chapter called Maps, which is all about his adventures in those woods and rafting.
Yeah.
So it was... I never got to experience it, but if you were there, if you were there when he was like rolling these out every few days, basically, I wonder if you were just like, wow, this is such a true story that I just knocked these memories loose in his head.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Totally.
Cause like this is, it's a story, right?
Right.
It's, it seems like it's probably autobiographical in some ways, but it seems like it's a fiction story. But how cool is that?
It's very cool.
In the comments to see it develop and then a few days later.
Yeah, have him, like the next chapter is written about something. Yeah.
It feels very like organic and immediate and real.
That's awesome.
In a way that I feel like a book can't really capture.
Yeah, totally. Well, also interactive, you know, to kind of see the author's process. That's a cool thing.
Yeah, and he's all over the original post. Like people are like... wow, that was an amazing story. And he is immediately commenting and going, well, thank you very much for reading that. That was very nice of you to say.
Yeah.
Really different. You don't get that with books.
Mm-mm.
Like this is a novel. It's called PenPal, a novel.
Mm-hmm.
But it's really a bunch of short stories on the internet bound together.
Right.
And I feel like I don't know how you ever could really do this. I wish that they could emulate some of that in the book. Because it is really cool.
Yeah.
Like, ostensibly, the format of it is supposed to be that he's remembering things a chunk at a time.
Okay.
The timeline bounces all over the place.
Yeah.
So in, like, the first chapter, he's, like, 9 or 10 or something.
Is it set up? Like, is there something I don't remember of him saying that it's him remembering things here and there? Or it just goes into it, right?
Kind of. He added two things, two chapters, quote-unquote. To this novel.
Yeah.
There's an intro called Memories where he sets up like the nature of memory.
Yeah.
And the fact that like, I think he's talking about how he was at an ice cream shop and he saw a kid and he gave the kid ice cream or something and she stopped crying and he's like, and I felt good about myself, but I have this weird feeling because I know she's not going to remember that.
Right.
She's not going to remember me.
Mm-hmm.
So even though I did something nice, it doesn't really matter. And that's what life is like.
Yeah.
Like you don't remember everything.
Yeah.
And he's like, but I remember something that happened to me when I was a kid.
Right.
What you're about to read are my recollections of what happened. Some things I always remembered. Some things I shook loose as I was writing
down. Right, I'm remembering now.
The things I recalled. So he does establish that we're going to be getting a pretty nonlinear story of him as a kid. But it is jumbly.
Yeah.
And I feel like some of that could be helped. Like, I really genuinely think that part of the story that doesn't make it to the book is that it's a dude writing stories on the internet.
Yeah. I mean, that would... Oh, Jesus.
Ooh, you okay? What'd you just do? What was that?
I'm glad that happened on camera.
I went to move, and I stepped on the cord.
You short sheeted yourself.
Yeah, that's exactly what I did.
Yeah.
That was scary.
That's awesome.
And now I'm watching the instant replay.
So weird.
What the fuck was I going to say? Oh, yeah, that's part of what's so cool about it, is that I knew the story behind it a little bit. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. I didn't know all the ins and outs. So, yeah, I do kind of wish there was some of that. Like, yeah. It just made me want to go look up everything about it. And if you and I weren't doing this and I didn't want you to tell me about it, that's what I would have done.
Yeah.
For just, like, an average Joe Schmo, maybe it would be good to have that kind of included in the story
somehow. I feel like it's part of it.
Like, context or something.
I feel like that's part of it. Mm-hmm. He tries to take what he had previously written and just posted online and expand it for the novel.
Mm-hmm.
And he comes up with a basic structure, which is, you know, he's remembering... I'm going to give a little more of the spoiler-free side just because I think it is helpful to know a little more. This is ostensibly a mystery.
Yeah.
It's also kind of a drama.
Mm-hmm.
It's also kind of a horror.
Mm-hmm.
And
something's going a little funky.
Well, nothing I can do about it. So it's kind of all over the map.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess the one thing that I feel like you need to know going into it is that it's about a kid who is – remembering, like, now he's a grown man, right? Mm-hmm. Like, as the story is being written, he's an adult recalling his childhood and realizing that a lot of the things he thought was going on are wrong.
Right.
There was a long stretch of time where he was actively being stalked by somebody who was capable of violence.
Yeah.
And so through remembering his childhood, he remembers what it was like to be there and to be innocent and not realize what was happening. Like, at one point, he's playing with his friend Josh in the woods, and they're like – we're talking about, like, the woods. Middle of nowhere woods.
Deep thickets.
Yes.
Yeah.
A lot of thickets.
Yeah.
Brambles. And they start joking around because they hear, like, a beeping and a whirring sound. Yeah. Very mechanical.
Yeah.
So they're like, oh, I think it's a robot. Beep, boop, blah, like, making jokes and shit. And then he's now remembering, as he's writing the story, no, that was somebody taking pictures of us.
Ugh.
So that's
– fucking pictures.
That's the kind of story that this is. And there's a lot going on in there. But the way that he frames it as in the novel is that he's learning about it by writing.
Right.
Writing is shaking memories loose.
Right.
And he's talking to his mother, and they're finally being honest with each other.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he's telling her about how he snuck out of the house sometimes, and she's revealing, like, oh, we didn't move.
Yeah.
Just because we moved.
Right.
I got us out of there.
She eventually does.
Yes.
Yeah.
So it's really interesting, and let's go into recommends, and then we'll get spoilery.
Yeah, I recommend.
You recommend?
Yeah.
Awesome. Mm-hmm. I'm very happy to hear that.
Yeah.
Because I had a weird experience reading the book this time.
Mm-hmm.
I recommend the book.
Yeah.
100%.
Mm-hmm.
Even more than that, I recommend going back and reading the original short stories.
I think that makes a lot of sense.
I think that, I think it's a valiant effort to try to take those six short stories and turn them into a novel.
Yeah.
But I think that everything that you would think could go wrong in doing that kind of went wrong.
Mm-hmm.
I think that it's padded out a lot.
Yeah.
And I don't mean this in a horrible way. I think that this guy this is a really interesting story that I have never seen anywhere else like it. And he deserves 100%. To have
Has he written anything else? You know?
No.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah, it's just a dude who has, like, a whole other job and everything, but he just wrote this sweet story.
I think so.
That's awesome.
At a certain point, he talked about how writing this book changed his life.
Uh-huh.
More specifically, posting these stories on NoSleep changed his life. After he published this book, the rights for it got picked up.
Mm-hmm.
So they are and have been since 2012 or 2013 developing a movie of PENPAL.
That's just in developmental hell.
Yes.
Know all about that.
I checked his Facebook page. He's not on Twitter. Mm-hmm. 1,000 Vultures. I checked his Facebook page. No updates since 2015 where he's saying things like, coming soon.
Hmm.
And so I want more.
I totally would watch whatever. Yeah,
absolutely. I want this as a movie.
Yeah,
I want him to write more stuff. I think it's amazing.
Yeah,
I love getting to like dig into something that mm-hmm. is totally experimental.
Yeah.
So when I say that I feel like the book is padded, I don't mean that as an insult.
Mm-hmm.
I mean that it is the first work of somebody who can do something amazing.
Yeah.
And
yeah, a lot of the stuff about like childhood nostalgia and everything that doesn't necessarily serve like the main, I guess you could say, plot of the book because it's so like all over the place. I don't know if you can necessarily call the mystery thing the main plot. I guess so.
Yeah.
But like all that stuff, even though it doesn't necessarily, some of it impact that, it's still very dead on. It feels yeah. right, you know? It's good. Agree. He's a good writer.
It feels like what it was mm-hmm. like to be a kid.
Totally. That's what I'm saying. It's exactly what it was like.
It's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, I highly recommend picking up this book because I think that Dathan Auerbach as a writer deserves any sales of the book.
Yeah, totally.
At all.
Yeah.
But I do think that the optimal way to get into these stories is to go look online and find the original posts.
Yeah.
I think there's just nothing else like it.
I mean, the fact that they're even still up there kind of shows that he's fine with you doing that.
Oh, 100%. I mean?
Otherwise, they'd be removed and you could only buy the book.
Totally.
Yeah.
And he has, like, totally embraced people, like, doing audio versions and doing short videos based on it.
That's so cool.
It's really cool. This
That's
is like
awesome.
A really interesting sort of new media independent production.
Yeah.
And I wish the book could somehow reflect that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But that's the only criticism that I have.
Yeah.
Is that it had to be expanded, and so it loses some of the pacing.
Mm-hmm.
Because the short stories are so
I'm sure. I'm sure you're just like, I can't wait to see the next one.
It's incredible.
Yeah.
I sat down to read them just to like as homework.
Yeah.
And ended up getting totally sucked into it.
Yeah.
And it was great.
Yeah.
So high recommend.
Yeah, totally. I thought it was really good.
Absolutely.
Cool. All right.
Spoilers.
Hold on to your butts.
Let's spoil this thing.
Let's see. Okay. An unnamed author takes us through an account of his childhood plagued by weirdness and jumping around in chronology. Almost all of the stories are about being stalked by an unseen force except for one, which is weird. A kindergarten pen pal project where the kid, in caps, that's what we're going to call him, sends off a balloon with a note in his address and starts... Wait, I wrote this weird. Well, I'm just going to keep going. And the kid starts getting back random blurry Polaroids, which he later realizes all have him in frame. Gross! He and his best friend Josh get into little boy shenanigans in the woods, and they are plagued by snapping branches, winds that seem to whisper, and, you know, an under porch dead animal catacomb mausoleum. Sick! We basically come to understand that the kid's mom had to move houses because she realized that a guy was fucking living under the porch, and you kind of infer that it was probably the same guy who was his Polaroid pen pal. You also infer that this guy hits and kills a girl with his car that the kid was on a date with, and at the very end, you infer that the same guy killed Josh after holding him captive for years, making him wear the kid's clothes. Well, I mean, you see that a guy definitely did that, but you infer that it's the guy. Why does no one have names in this book? PenPal was a little unsatisfying for me in its vagueness and a little uneven. I don't understand why we jump around in time, really, and I would like to have known more about this fucking creepy kid stalker and killer. But it's one of those things. But is it one of those things where that's the point? So often in real life, we don't know, or is it a string of particularly well-written Reddit creepypastas that became a book, and I'm thinking too hard about it? Hard to say. Keeping in mind that this wasn't a seasoned author and it's really cool that this even became a book, I really enjoyed reading it and I would give it a schmuck high recommend. Just don't look for all the answers to fill you up. This might be one bowl of creepypasta that still leaves you feeling a little peckish.
See, now, that's what would be on the back of the
book. That's why I was concerned.
That's what would be like on the book jacket. From Kristen Rogers of Book Club.
I don't know, but that's saying that you want a little bit more because you weren't satisfied enough. So would they advertise it using that? Perhaps no.
Probably not.
Yeah.
It'd be a questionable thing to put on the book, I guess. I completely agree.
Mm-hmm.
I think that part of the fun of this is that it's independent. It's a little bit, it's a little bit rough around the edges.
Yeah.
I really appreciate that about it. I like it as an experiment. Mm-hmm. I like it as a story.
Yeah.
Like absolutely up and down. I like it a lot as a story that you could like, you could sit down and tell someone what this is about, and it sounds really weird and confusing.
Totally.
And I also, I'm calling it a complaint, but it is also something that I like about it, that in reading it, you're like, weird choice. That's a weird choice. I like watching people develop.
Yeah.
And so I feel like it's fun on that level, too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The jumping around in time, I get theoretically, like, these things came back to him, but it's confusing to me, kind of, you know?
I completely
agree. And I also don't understand what the Mrs. Maggie... the Mrs. Maggie chapter, like, doesn't really...
That chapter is maps.
Yeah.
And that is probably my least favorite
chapter.
It's just
out of left field. It doesn't have anything to do with the main thing.
Yeah.
It's a creepy, you know, story, and then kind of, like... not the strongest ending ever.
Yep.
Like, that feels like kind of just an average creepypasta, basically.
Yeah. Well, you know what it is?
What?
Each one of these chapters is a twist. Each chapter is an M. Night Shyamalan movie.
Shyamalan?
How do you say it? Shyamalan.
Shyamalan? You're like, Shyamalan.
I'll just say M. Night. Should I just say M?
I actually kind of like that.
Evidently, he tells people to call him Knight.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
The guy who plays Dante said that on a podcast, and it made me cringe.
But I don't know. Maybe it's just what he goes by.
Well,
like, he always, like, isn't that his name?
It wasn't that alone. It was also that, so the guy that plays Dante plays, like, a truck driver in the movie The Happening.
Uh-huh.
And he...
What happened? Oh, okay. Yeah.
I never saw the movie.
That's with, like, Mark Wahlberg, where people keep killing themselves, right?
Yes.
Okay.
And he told a story about how he walked up to M. Night Shyamalan.
Uh-huh.
Now I feel very...
That sounded better to me.
Self-conscious about it.
I think the first time you were just like,
Shyamalan.
Yeah.
He walked up to M. Night Shyamalan and said, "Where's Roz? Where's Rerun?" Oh, I thought this was the What's Happening movie. He told that as if that was like...
Neat joke.
A clever thing to do or not an obnoxious thing.
Yeah.
To distract somebody.
What? Like, I'm working on my movie.
What's that, Dante? I'm busy. I'm checking the angles. Oh, what's that? The best boy needs me. I have to go talk to the best boy.
The best boy.
Sorry, Dante.
He's one of my favorite people on a movie. That's like The Grip and Key Grip.
What about the gaffer?
Nah, fuck the gaffer. I've got no time for him.
when we lived in Missouri, I was friends with this kid, Mike.
Uh-huh.
And he loved Stone Cold Steve Austin.
Yep, remember that.
And we used to watch this one Stone Cold Steve Austin VHS all the time.
Yeah.
And I just watched it because I was friends with him. I was just there. And
that's like me watching Backstreet Boys like live concert VHS tapes.
Yeah, it's just friend. Like, I'm just there.
All right, it's fine.
And
yeah.
During the credits... as the names are scrolling by, it would say, like, director, and then in parentheses, candy ass. And it got down to gaffer, and it said, yeah, I whooped his ass, too. And I didn't know what a gaffer was. I thought they just put funny words in there.
I love that.
Like, I thought the whole thing was a joke. I didn't know there were real credits plus little side
That's amazing.
Conversation gags. I didn't know what was going on.
I wonder whose idea that was. Like, was that Stone Cold's idea? Or a producer's idea.
Some bored
or like
producer.
The person who puts like types it all out there like, you know, it would be funny. And then got in touch or something.
Yeah. It's a little bit like you remember the one Looney Tunes thing where like somebody is like it's in the cartoon, like Daffy Duck is like running around doing stuff, and then a hand comes in and erases his feet.
And then they
eventually pan back in the end of the sketch is that it was Bugs Bunny. He's like, ain't I a stinker?
Yeah.
And he was the artist.
Yeah.
It's a little bit suggesting that Stone Cold Steve Austin is editing his own, like,
yeah,
I gotta edit this thing to get it out by noon. The gaffer, I whooped his candy ass too.
Does he still wrestle?
I don't know. I saw a picture of The Undertaker the other day.
He still wrestles? I thought he died.
He looks like he died.
I really thought The Undertaker died.
I guess not.
I feel like there was some wrestler.
He did not look good. The picture I saw of him, he did not look good.
He still looks big. I had like a friend who drove me to school or something who some wrestler died and they were really bummed about it. And I thought it was them, but I guess not, obviously.
I have no
cool
idea.
Story.
I don't know.
Yeah.
yeah. Wow.
What were you doing that you had occasion to see The Undertaker?
Oh, I don't know. I just saw it online. So
yeah.
I don't remember.
You just got lucky.
I guess so. I've been very, I'm blessed. Hashtag blessed. So anyway, what we were talking about.
Pen pal.
Yeah, I know. But why? What were we saying? Right.
I said, what the fuck? Hang on. I read the thing. My summary.
We started talking.
The Mrs. Maggie chapter.
Okay.
And how it was like, meh.
So I think that, the reason that it's like all over the place, like with the timeline and everything, I gotta assume that as he was writing it on Reddit,
mm-hmm. yeah.
he did not know where he was gonna go right. with it. Right? Like, I think that it literally...
Right, which is really cool.
Yes, yeah. it is cool. And I think that he did a great job of being, mm-hmm. like, in, like, the fourth story, putting in a little thing that ties back to the first story. But I don't think he had any of it planned.
Yeah.
And the fact of the matter is, these are direct translations from those posts just into book form.
Mm-hmm.
His final story he posted at the beginning of October 2011.
Yeah.
This book was published, like, 8 months later, 9 months later.
Right.
So I think that he had no time. He did everything very breakneck pace. So I think mm-hmm. it's literally... copied and pasted his stories, mm-hmm. put them in chapter form, and just wrote some bigger things in there, and that was it.
I mean, it obviously worked and everything, but I guess I wonder if it would have been a good idea to either one of two things, maybe. Either have the book be more clear about how it was written and everything, so you're aware of all that, and it makes a little bit more sense that it is not totally cohesive in a way. Or the same way we're always like, oh, a TV show or a movie is like a way to do an edit of something. Or if waiting a little bit longer, I mean, I understand the excitement. I probably do the same thing.
Yeah.
But waiting a little bit longer and then kind of editing it into a more complete thing as a standalone book aside from its origins.
Yes.
If one of those things might have made a little bit more sense.
I completely agree. I 100% agree. I think that part of it also, and this is dumb,
mm-hmm.
and it, I'm going to talk about Scream.
Okay.
Again now?
Ready for it.
Here we go. So Scream 4 came out in 2011.
Yeah.
And in that movie.
Really?
Yeah.
That was 6 years ago we went to see that?
Yeah.
When we were spooksters?
Yeah. Wanting to know everybody.
Yeah. Will and I saw it in theaters. I'll tell this real quick. We've definitely talked about it on the show before. But there were people yelling at the screen and this girl was like, why gotta be a spookster? Always wanting to know everybody.
And then Chris and I were just like, what does that mean?
And then, like, at some point was like, in those same nasty-ass pajamas you wore yesterday or something like that.
And her friend started laughing so hard.
Yeah.
No idea what was going on. So in that movie, there's a character named Robbie,
mm-hmm.
who is always live streaming.
I remember. Oh, okay. Yeah,
he has
a
camera. He has a headset mm-hmm. with a camera on one side that is filming 100% of everything that he is doing.
Yeah.
And he's putting it all online. He's streaming his life, basically.
Did he get to live? Spoiler alert.
No.
Oh, he didn't get to enter the age of GoPros. Well, poor Robbie. Or did he? Is that a GoPro?
I mean, it's kind of a GoPro.
Okay.
At the time, I distinctly remember looking at it and being like, no one does this. And I thought of it as an example of like Kevin Williamson and Wes Craven, mm-hmm. like, oh no, like 20 years makes a big difference.
Yeah.
In the 90s, you guys were applauded for capturing the way that people spoke,
mm-hmm.
specifically like how kids spoke and acted.
I don't.
You can disagree, but they were applauded for that.
Okay.
No, Kevin Williamson characters.
I think that they may applaud for giving teens more credit than they're given in a lot of movies, but for actual realism?
Yes.
No. Nobody, yes. With Kevin, nobody was like, oh yeah, in Dawson's Creek, that's how kids talk.
I'm telling you. I agree with you.
That's I agree ridiculous. With
you. Kevin Williamson characters live in like a Kevin Williamson world.
And where, I really like it, P.S., but that is not.
Where like there are no words that have less than 3 syllables.
I was going to say exactly the same thing.
And like everybody knows every reference,
both literary and in movies. Ever.
Yeah, 100. I totally agree.
Yeah.
But like he had characters that were like really just kind of like very familiar with each mm-hmm. other. And they were all kind of just like generally screw ups, and they felt somewhat authentic.
Mm-hmm.
He was like really applauded for that, and especially for capturing the 90s teenager.
Yeah.
And so I remember looking at this kid live streaming his life and being like, well, that is, he's lost it.
Yeah.
And like now he's 20 years older and he does not know what kids are like.
Uh huh.
I gotta tell you, what are we now? 7 years later?
Yeah.
He was ahead of the curve.
I'm about to say, yeah, completely.
He was 100% right. And he got there early.
I can't believe that was 6 years ago. Are you sure?
It was 7 years ago.
Wait, you said it was 2011.
It was 6 years ago. It is not 2018.
Yeah.
Right now.
No.
I don't know where I am.
Yeah.
In time.
Yeah, so Snapchat, I guess, wasn't a thing.
Right.
Instagram wasn't a thing. Shit, what did we do?
Smartphones were barely a thing.
William, are you sure?
I'm pretty sure.
That doesn't seem...
I'm going to look it up right now.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure. Scream 4.
That seems like so long
2011.
Ago.
It came out in 2011, Kristen.
That's insane.
Yeah.
Okay.
We were...
Weird.
We were in our 20s.
God, can you imagine? Were we ever that young?
To be that young? Has it been that long?
Yeah, apparently.
Yeah, but like he was 100% ahead.
Yeah.
And there's one of the killers, their motive...
Yeah, so he invented GoPro.
Kind of, yeah.
Yeah.
And then one of the killers, their whole motive was really cornball, and I still think it's cornball.
Yeah.
But one of the lines was, I don't need friends, I need fans. Cringy?
Very cringy, but also...
100% right, and it's yes. only getting more true.
I know, it's on the money. I feel like you don't go on Instagram that much, right?
No.
But like, there are so many bot accounts now that are just like commenting on things.
Yeah.
You know, it's just like...
Oh, it's insane.
Just saying like, brilliant. Like, uh-huh. That happens so often. It's yeah. so stupid.
Yeah. Well, even like, if you look at like kids online mm-hmm. who do those like prank videos.
Yeah.
Where like, they just like, they like hurt them. Well, I mean, it's like kind of jackass, I guess. But yeah. they do some where they like humiliate strangers. And like, there are all those things where it's like, there was this guy who did these prank videos mm-hmm. where he pretended to be a blind guy. And what? Then he would walk up to people and give them a $100 bill. He would reach uh-huh. out and be like, hey, can you give me change?
Uh-huh.
I just need change for a 20.
Uh-huh.
But he was oh. really handing them a $100 bill.
Uh-huh.
And then he was trying to ostensibly see
yeah.
if they would be honest
yeah.
and give him change for $100
right.
or point out that he was holding $100
right.
20
yeah.
or would they just take the money
mm.
and give him like $10 mm-hmm. or you know, whatever the hell back.
Yeah.
And it was later exposed that he had paid people.
Ugh.
To steal the money.
That's so stupid.
And then people started spotting their friends in this video, their family yeah. members being like, you stole from a blind guy.
Oh, and they're like, no, but they paid me to do it. It's a yes. whole thing. Yeah, yes. yeah, yeah.
Kevin Williamson was completely right. I don't think he knew it.
Yeah,
but totally. He was completely right, and it's only getting worse. Now, yes. the reason that I bring all of this up
yeah.
is because I think that 2011,
mm-hmm.
We were obviously well into the age of the internet.
Yeah.
Everybody was already doing like Facebook had been around for years and yeah. years and years.
Mm-hmm.
We were no strangers to like living our lives online as well.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think that the culture of the internet had really been cultivated yet to
yeah.
the point where Dathan Auerbach mm-hmm. writing PenPal
mm-hmm.
could publish his novel
yeah.
referring to the fact that it was on internet forums.
I think that probably is true.
I think that it would have in 2011, I think yeah. that it would have been looked down on.
Yeah, it could have
and
like
seem lesser.
Painted him as a Dorcas Malorcus.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Dorcas Maximus.
You don't want that.
No. They'd kick him right
kill
in his,
book sales.
They'd kick him right in his Gluteus Maximus and say, get out of my Walden books. I want
you don't
this.
Belong in this B. Dalton.
I want this gone from my borders.
I miss borders.
2011.
Yeah.
Different world.
Yeah.
But you know what I mean? Like, I feel like yeah. if you did this now,
mm-hmm.
I think that it could only benefit.
Oh, completely.
From pointing out the new media aspects of it. I feel like that is integral to the story.
Completely. Because, like, there's not that much that is totally dorky anymore. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, they're very – I'm trying to think what would – not really, because there's just kind of like, there always has been, but now it's easier to find people who are interested in the same things that you are.
Yeah.
So like, I guess like bronies, I guess everybody would think that was really weird.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, like things
but
like that, I guess.
That's a
but,
very specific like subculture.
Yes, totally.
You know, like, yeah. like the internet was dorky.
So like
in 20-
not, writing things on Reddit is not dorky. I guess it right. could have been back then.
It could have been, yeah. but that was mm-hmm. like a thing where it's like, well, at some point, we're all going to embrace doing a bunch of things online.
Right.
And we probably could have, like, seen that coming.
Mm-hmm.
Like, bronies is not a good comparison because it's not like we can look at bronies and be like, yeah, I think it's dorky now, but in the future, we'll all be doing it.
But in 2011, maybe we wouldn't have thought that about writing out short stories on Reddit.
True.
It's not as extreme as, I mean, bronies. You're right. It's not a great comparison. But it's also not the worst either. You know what I
yeah.
mean? Like.
Yeah.
It's hard to look back and see whether we would think that was cool or not. But I think you're probably right. At that time, it probably wouldn't have sold the book more.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Friend me on pony.com. I'm Sparkle Klop. Can't wait to see you guys in the chat. Sparkle Klop.
I guarantee that's taken.
It's probably taken. Yes.
Guarantee.
Totally agree.
Did you watch the documentary about bronies?
No.
Oh, it was good.
I don't watch documentaries.
What? They're so good.
Dry nerd truth.
Now I'm the nerd.
Yeah. No, I haven't.
Yeah.
I would.
Yeah, it's great. It's on Netflix. I saw it like years ago.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Pardon the interruption. Book Club Shmook Club has no sponsors, so instead we rely on our listeners and patrons. If you enjoy the show, please consider going to patreon.com/talkbomb to help us cover our hosting fees and book fees, and to get dozens of Patreon-exclusive shows as a thank you. Please also consider leaving us a review on iTunes or Stitcher to brighten our day and maintain our show's reputation. If you like Book Club Shmook Club, the best thing you can do for us is to share the show with a friend. If you like this podcast, there's a good chance your friends will too. No matter what, we just hope you enjoy the show, though. So let's get back into it.
All right. So the actual story itself, I feel like,
yes, I know
the way that it was done is important.
Yes, completely. But
the story itself is significantly
let's head
cool.
inside the book.
Yeah.
Step on in.
Hey, Chris, let's go in.
I'm going to step on the mic cord again. Like in Mist.
Through the pages of a good book. everybody, actually, you can go right now to look up our most recent Myst playthrough.
Yeah, if you need something to put you to sleep.
YouTube.com/WB2045. We will not be doing that again.
No, it's no good.
I repeat.
It's so tedious.
Go look it up. Player zero. Anyway,
Yeah.
I don't even know how you want to do this, because my thing would be to literally go story by story, because I do feel like they are standalone things. Mm-hmm. But I know that you don't really like doing that.
I mean, if we can keep it snappy, at least it's not like 20 stories or anything.
True.
So,
okay.
Yeah.
So
still within the, you know, keep an eye on the clock, so to speak.
Fair enough.
But yeah, we can do that, because it's only like five parts or something.
Yeah,
so,
exactly.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So the first one is called Footsteps.
Yeah.
And this story is basically about he wakes up in the middle of the woods.
Right.
And doesn't know where the hell he is.
Right.
Now, the twist ending at this one, when he finally gets back home, it's the middle of the night.
Right.
His mom thinks that he had run away.
Right.
And he's like, well, why'd you think I ran away? Why'd you think I wasn't just like running around outside? And she goes, well, I found your letter that you wrote that you were running away. And he looks at it, and there's a letter saying that he's running away from home and he's not coming back.
Right.
So of course she thought that. She called the police.
Right.
And then he realizes, whoa, this is not how you spell my name. I did not write this.
Right. Which is, why didn't his mom know? I guess just in your panic is the answer. But like, it's not in his handwriting. And it's not how you spell his name.
100% right.
So
I would think that the thing would be, that's not my handwriting.
Yeah.
That's not how you spell my name.
Yeah, completely.
Because if I write a note to you.
Of course, I can't imagine who wouldn't know how to spell Dathan. There's
the camera. That's also a weird thing. The author is Dathan Auerbach.
Yeah.
I have to assume that the kid is Dathan Auerbach. But
yeah,
like you pointed out, there are no names in this.
Right. Right. Well, just not his name and not
the bad,
bad guy's name. Like, you know, mom is just mom or whatever.
Right.
So, yeah.
But yeah, that is weird. Mm-hmm. But yeah, if I wrote a note to you about how I never want to see you again, and it's signed W-I-L-L-Y-U-M. you'd be like...
William.
William. You'd be like, what?
Yeah, I would know somebody had kidnapped you.
Yeah.
Of course.
Exactly.
Like, why would the mom be like, oh my God, he ran away from home. Weird.
And he doesn't know how to spell his own name.
Yeah.
Maybe you should stay gone.
And also, what is this killer's MO? Like, why would he kidnap him and then just bring him to the middle of the woods by himself? Like, I guess maybe he likes watching him, like, figure out a situation, I guess.
I don't know. My real answer.
You can't know.
My real answer is outside the story. My real answer is that Dathan Auerbach wrote a short story to put on Reddit.
Yeah.
And he had thought of a twist ending.
Totally.
And that was the end.
I think that that's true.
Yeah. Yeah,
so I think that's another one of those things where if you maybe edited it a little bit more to be a standalone book, there might be something more to that.
Yes. But I also don't know why then when you're expanding it into a novel.
Right.
You wouldn't fix some of these things. Because those are very immediate, they stand out sore thumb problems.
Yeah, totally.
That's not how you spell my name is a big problem. Your mom didn't notice that either.
Yeah.
It should be handwriting.
Mm-hmm.
She should recognize his handwriting as well.
Also,
but
how dumb is this kidnapper killer?
I know.
Now that I think about it.
Yeah.
Why would you even bother leaving a note like that?
Well, there's something wrong with
it. And your grown-up handwriting and spelling the kid's name wrong.
Well, we'll find out in like future stories. I don't even know what is wrong with this man. There's something like, I don't think that there's an answer for this, but there's something seriously wrong with his brain.
There are a lot of questions. Like, you know, this is no spoiler because I already talked about the whole story. But at the very end, like the way that you find out that the kid, Dathan's friend, Josh, is dead. Is that the guy, like, made a coffin and buried himself alive with the kid?
Yeah.
Like, what did he want? Why? What did he want? What was going on? Like, I wish that I knew, because that's such a weird and bizarre,
yes, it's
fucked up thing. Like, right. That's something where I would like to know what the killer's MO was.
I totally agree. I don't think you're supposed to think anything other than, oh my God, that's weird and sick.
Yeah, completely. Yeah, yeah, but I would like to think more.
Yeah, it kind of reminds me of Postmortem, when we read Patricia Cornwall's Postmortem. Remember when we read that, Master Wayne? But like, the killer guy is referred to as a shape.
Yeah.
And you don't really get to know him. And yeah. Then at a certain point he shows up and then he's gone and you never find out what his deal was.
Right. Right.
It reminds me of that. We're just like, the bad guy in PenPal is omnipresent, but you have no idea what he's doing or what he's capable of.
Completely.
Sometimes he's living under the house, which suggests that he doesn't have a home.
Yeah.
But then he has his own car.
That part's fucked up.
Oh, the whole book is fucked
up.
The whole book is great.
But it's funny that you bring up Postmortem, because you talking about him just kind of giving an update about what was going to happen possibly with the movie or something and then never hearing anything again reminds me of Postmortem, that it's just been in development,
right,
like purgatory forever.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right. Interesting.
Yeah.
Curiouser and curiouser.
It really is. So, yeah, so that's that chapter.
Well, the only other thing that I have to say about that is just – this was, I thought, a good example of taking the original short stories and when you blow them up too much, they start to lose their impact.
Mm-hmm.
In the original short story, the kid sees his house. He's finally gotten his orientation. He's finally getting out of the woods.
Mm-hmm.
And he sees his house and all the lights are on. He's like, oh, my God, my mom is up and she's looking for me.
Yeah.
And he starts running towards the house and he can see her silhouette like in the window.
Mm-hmm.
And he's running up the back porch stairs and he goes to open the door and someone grabs him from behind.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And he's like, no, let me go, mom. And then she just goes like, it's okay.
Yeah.
She's the person that grabbed him from behind.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then the door opens in front of him, and it's a cop.
Yeah.
It was a cop in the house. In the book, expanded, he sees the house. He's running up. He sees his mom's silhouette in the window. He runs up. He's running up the stairs. He's about to reach for the door. Arms grab him from behind.
Uh-huh.
And he's like, no, let me go. Mom! And
yeah.
He starts kicking. And he's kicking. And the arms, there's something wrong with the arms. They look like they're furry or something. And he's clawing. He's reaching forward. And he's hoping that he'll see his mother again. And what's going on? And he's fighting. Mom, no, let me go. Who are you? Mom!
You're really putting on a little play here.
Well, that's what's going on. There's like so much.
I know, but.
And then it's like, it's okay. It's me, honey.
Yeah.
That's supposed to be very sort of like, bam, quick.
Uh-huh.
Almost goosebumpsy.
Uh-huh.
Where it's like, something grabbed me from behind. Oh. It's my mom.
Yeah.
Oh, it should be like a very quick, oh, mommy. Ooh, mama. It's supposed to be like a very quick, like, oh, everything's deflating. It's okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
But to make it like the length of a novel, it's stretched out to the, for me at least, I thought, and I was curious to hear your thoughts of this. To me, it was stretched to the point where it was like, wow, you can't even pay this off anymore.
I don't remember thinking about it either way, to tell you the truth.
Then great.
Yeah.
Then great. I should also point out, I think I did the absolute wrong thing reading the book for this. I should have read the novel and then read the short stories if I wanted to do that. I did the opposite. I read the short stories and then I read the novel.
Yeah.
So I could feel.
Nice one, real.
I know. I really wish I hadn't. I could feel when it was being like stretched.
Right, right. So then there was an edit, right? There were differences then, if you're saying it was stretched. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, 100%.
Okay.
I thought
there were no differences.
Most of it is stuff that where it's like totally got nothing to do with anything.
Mm-hmm.
Where like they have a snow cone business in one of the chapters.
Yeah.
And then like he just goes on for like a page and a half about what his snow cone machine was like.
I know.
And it's like, well, but that doesn't have anything to do with anything.
Completely. But for some reason there was something – I don't know. There's something about his writing style or the friendship between the boys or something where even though I felt that and I was like, all right, so I have a snow cone machine.
Right.
It still didn't bother me.
I agree.
It was still sweet, I guess, is the thing. It was cute.
I totally agree. Yeah. You can just feel him not getting there.
Yeah.
You can feel him driving forward and then going on a little detour for a little while.
I kind of felt like he was getting caught up, possibly maybe, like getting caught up in nostalgia and kind of indulging it a little bit too much, maybe.
But ostensibly, you know, the format in the original post is that he's posting online and he's actively trying to remember and he's talking to people in the chat.
Right.
For the book, it's just that like, oh my God, I remembered this thing and it's got me on this path of remembering the rest of the crazy stuff that happened to me.
Yeah.
And when you frame it that way, for him to be like, I was being stalked.
Mm-hmm.
And he came and he was standing there in front of me, and I only realized that now.
Yeah.
Let me tell you about my snow cone machine. it just doesn't yeah. match the right tone. It doesn't yeah. feel the same.
Yeah.
Yeah, so okay, so that's footsteps. Mm-hmm. Yeah. The next one I want to say is balloons.
I think so. And yes, because it sets up the whole thing.
Yes, this is yeah. like the chapter
yeah.
that establishes what this book is about, mm-hmm. and it is cool.
Yeah, it's sweet.
Awesome. I love it.
Yeah.
From the idea of it's like a class project that mm-hmm. you attach a photo of yourself, which is like a weird thing.
Yeah.
I don't doubt for a second that happens
yes.
in some classes. Yeah. Probably not these days.
I don't think today, but I think it did.
Yeah. yeah. You attach a photo of yourself to a balloon. It's a cool project. It's great. It's yeah. really cool. You let the balloon fly away. Someone's yeah. going to catch it and get your picture and get a note from you.
Yeah, totally.
And they can send their responses to mm-hmm. the school, and you have a pen pal.
Mm-hmm.
But he doesn't get a letter back.
Yeah.
Until he starts getting pictures.
Yeah.
And they're all blurry, and they're all
mm-hmm. I was like, whew, this is bad news.
Indecipherable.
Doesn't you can't seem good.
Tell. There's no subject in any of the photos
yeah.
until he looks at all of them together.
Yep.
And did that strike? Are there, for me, there are moments where all of a sudden there's a punch.
Yes.
And this was like mm-hmm. when he's looking at all the pictures, he's like, wait a minute. Why am I in this?
Yeah.
That hit you?
Yeah.
That's great.
Yep. It was great.
I wish I could.
I was scared a little bit reading this sometimes.
Really?
Well, I mean, you know what I mean? Scared.
Right.
But yes, because there was some night, what the fuck? I watched something scary on TV, and then I went to read this, and I was like, Kristen, slow it up. Or I was listening to like a scary podcast or something like that, and I was like, everything's too scary around me.
I wish that I could read this for the first time again.
Yeah.
Because mm-hmm. I know what's coming. I was reading it to reacquaint myself with it.
Yeah.
But I wish I could feel these moments again.
Yeah.
I remember being like glued to mm-hmm. the screen and being like, oh my God, he's yeah. in the pictures.
Yes.
The guy is walking around taking pictures of him and then sending him the pictures.
Completely.
And not only
and
that,
he's like five.
Yeah. And not only that, because the picture.
Like, it's weird to taunt a five-year-old with.
Is it taunting? Because that's the question that like I really want to start to figure out as well.
Okay.
Is like, what is this guy doing and what is wrong with him? Is it taunting him that he's sending him pictures?
I don't think there's any way to know what's wrong with him because we don't know enough about him at all.
I don't think we can really diagnose him. But like, if we can like try to figure out like – because I think he behaves inconsistently.
I do think he's taunting him because he sends him the pictures. He comes to his snow cone stand.
Yes. That was cool. So
that was another moment where I was – it actually took me a minute weirdly. I must have just been like having a moment or something. I was like, huh, what are the chances of getting the same dollar back?
Yeah, he wrote for stamps on the dollar. And then at the end of the day, yeah. when they were splitting up their money from their snow cone stand, he's got the dollar that says for stamps on
it. I thought it just ended up back to him at first.
Right.
I was like, wow, that's such a neat thing. For
Lucky penny.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And I was like, well, no, wait a second.
That man was there.
Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah, I do think he's kind of, well.
He's playing a game of some sort. He likes to get close and then yeah. back off.
Yeah.
Sounds
like my ex-husband. Anyway.
Wow. it's so stupid.
I disagree.
But yeah, I guess that would be the theme then. It's mm-hmm. only making sense now. He's like, he kidnaps him in the night
yeah.
and leaves a note, but only takes him so far into the woods and leaves him.
And doesn't do anything to him. I mean, thank God.
I mean, I would assume that that's something where it's like, all right, I'm finally gonna kidnap yeah. this kid. And then like, oh my God, what am I doing? What am I doing? And then just leaves him in the woods. And he's like, all right, I didn't touch him. I'm going away.
I don't know. Well, that's another thing where the chronology is kind of a pain in the ass. Because yeah. then you can't see a progression of what he's done. So maybe it yes. is like that. I'm not sure. Because what my thought just now is like, well, no, because he continues to fuck with him or something like that. But like, no, maybe that was like close to the last thing or something.
Although he does.
I can't remember. No,
he does
it couldn't
reference
have been, actually.
Like falling asleep on the top bunk of his bed and then waking up on the bottom bunk. Is that the guy creeping in and lifting him out of the top bunk and moving him to the bottom?
Jesus Christ.
Like, is he just fucking with him endlessly? He's
I
always
forgot about
there.
That. I guess so. These guys are all.
I do think
sick
that the
patootie.
Book. He is. He's a sick puppy.
Yeah.
I do think
it's
that
a
the
bad
book
potato.
Is.
He's going to ruin the bunch.
You know, they say one bad potato ruins the bunch. Get that bad potato out of there. You're going to ruin the whole bunch. That's somebody on a piece of scaffolding in a potato factory shouting down to the factory floor.
What? And then it just keeps going on the
potato.
Conveyor belt.
What? It's on. It's in block four. You want some more? We have plenty. It's a potato factory. We manufacture potatoes.
This is so dumb. Part of what's making me laugh is just picturing like a bunch of potatoes on a conveyor belt. Like, what are the people who were there doing?
Like, just watching.
Like, why is there someone up there yelling to the person?
He's the bad potato spotter. What's He's up there with a telescope.
Why is the bad potato spotter so far away?
So here's what you're going to do. You're replacing the last guys who go up on this scaffolding. About 50 feet in the air, and here's your telescope to look down and see the potatoes.
I'm picturing like...
Couldn't I be on the floor and look at them? No. You're not going to fit in here if you don't learn.
You keep asking questions. I'm basically picturing the Honey Bunches of Oats commercial where like it's everybody in the factory, like processing oats, but it's just all potatoes. Remember that lady? She's like, whenever I go out, everybody's like, ooh, you smell so good. I say it's because I work at the Honey Bunches of Oats factory. Do you know what I'm talking about?
That no.
Oh, that commercial's been on for like... 15 years.
Really?
It's a black woman, and she says that. I can't think of another way to describe it. And she's got the hairnet on. And it's like, it's almost like a commercial about how great it is to work at the Honey Bunches of Oats factory.
I guess they're talking about how good. I work at the potato factory. Yeah, it's just... You get daily contact with potatoes?
Smelling dirty potatoes.
You're permitted daily contact with potatoes? Jesus.
And there's some weird pervert who gets a job at the potato factory for reasons you don't want to know. He shouldn't be permitted daily contact with potatoes.
Hands off the merch. Hands off the merchandise, number 23.
I see you.
Oh, my God. Yeah, so what we're trying to say is the guy in PenPal is a real bad potato. So,
I called him a sick patootie and a bad potato. Child's killer.
That's insane.
I go light on that kind of crime.
Yeah.
Apparently.
We got another bad potato. Yeah, hi. I just moved in. I'm new to town, but I have to go door to door to let you know I'm on the bad potato list.
I'm a bit of a sick patootie, so I think it's a... I guess the state thinks it's important that you know that.
Honey, the sick patootie moved in next door. Just inform me.
Yeah.
I didn't know what to say.
What do you say to that? So, yeah. So, I forgot about that. About the bed moving.
Yeah. Yeah, I think he's just always there.
Yeah.
Because, like, he makes contact.
He's a spookster, always want to know everybody.
He is always want.
But only that kid.
He is a spookster.
Yeah.
Spooksters just want to know everybody.
Yeah.
Wow. You're right.
He's a spookster.
But, like, we only know about, really, the things where he's, like, making overt contact.
Right.
He gets the dollar that says for stamps on it, so he pays for something.
Yeah.
To the kid, so that he can just be there and, like, give him a clue that he was nearby.
That. Yeah.
And send him all these pictures that the kid is in.
Right.
But here's the thing. Mm-hmm. This sounds like a guy who's very dedicated to what he's doing,
yeah.
But he's also a guy who's taken over 50 pictures of this kid,
yeah.
And he can't keep the camera focused or steady, or like sometimes the bottom corner.
I figured that was part of it.
Like he's like deliberately.
Yeah, yeah. It was like deliberately vague or something.
Oh, I totally.
That you could be like, oh, it's just a picture of me. Just a picture of something, and then be like, wait a second, like eventually.
Yeah, I guess.
That's what I assumed, because. Honestly, he wouldn't be able to keep... I feel like it'd be too much of a giveaway. He wouldn't be able to kind of keep up his thing because an adult would be like, oh my God, Dathan's receiving pictures of himself in the mail. Like, doesn't the teacher even see? And she's this is interesting.
How are you going to stop somebody from sending you mail?
But they could start... There could start being a cop detail on the kid and stuff.
Oh, I guess that's true.
You know what I mean? So it would kind of like... You know, the game is still afoot if he sends him these blurry, weird pictures.
Yeah.
But if he directly sends him a picture of him, like, smiling and, like... eating an ice cream cone, then somebody's going to be like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
You know?
Ah, it's so fucking weird.
It's so creepy. Yeah.
So the next one is boxes.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, this one takes place after Dathan and his mom have moved further away.
How the fuck did the mom stay in there a minute longer after suspecting that there was a man like living in the house or under the house or whatever?
Well, they didn't. The way that it works, this story...
I thought she figured it out, and they were still in it for, like, not a long time, but, okay.
No, this one is... they're already in the process of moving, because now she knows that her son's being stalked. Mm-hmm. And the cat, they're trying to like find the cat. It ran under the house in this crawl space.
Cat's name is Boxes.
Cat's name is Boxes. The mom goes under the house in the crawl space to try to get the cat, mm-hmm. finds the cat, comes out and looks upset.
Yeah.
The next thing the kid knows is that they're moving.
I don't know why I was having a hard time with
because
this.
Because she spoke to the realtor and convinced them to let them move into the new place early.
Okay.
They don't even bring all their stuff.
I completely forgot that she had just gone to find the cat.
Yes.
Okay. Gotcha.
And then, yeah, what we find out later, now that Dathan and Josh are trying to – the cat ran away again now that it's years later. They try to go back to the old house thinking maybe the cat went back to the old house.
Yeah.
And Dathan goes under the house in the crawl space. Josh goes up inside the house. So Dathan can hear everything that's happening through the floorboards.
This was so scary.
I love this.
Yeah, it's great.
Josh hides in the closet because he can hear that somebody's in the house. Oh, God. It's obviously, you know, the guy.
Yeah.
He's dragging a...
And also, they were told that the house... They thought that people lived in the house. Right. Like, people had moved in, and they get there, and it's just abandoned. It looks like shit.
Yes. So the guy is in there, and he's dragging a bag that seems to be moving.
Mm-hmm.
So does he have other projects?
I don't know. I wasn't sure about that.
Yeah.
I don't know.
They're talking on walkie-talkies, and Josh is like – first of all, there are two weird things I thought was interesting. He's like, hey, why do you like dudes' butts so much? Like, you got a bunch of pictures of dudes' butts in here. And it's just like a dumb kid joke.
Totally. It made me laugh at first. It
made me laugh until I was like,
a little kid thing to say.
But then I was like, well, maybe there's actually pornography in this.
Wait a second. God, what the fuck is the matter with me? I didn't get so much about this book.
Yeah.
I thought it was just a kid making a joke.
Well, remember, I've read this 4 times.
Okay. I thought he was just completely joking.
No.
It did not even occur to me.
I read it as him not joking. I read it as him joking the first couple of times. I now read it as he might be joking.
Okay.
Or he may have found, because this guy's squatting in this house, there are pictures of the kid, of Dathan, all over the place.
Yes.
And pornography.
Okay. So when I read it, I
gotta stop saying pornography. I'm just going to say porn.
Yeah, totally.
It sounds very clinical. It sounds like a senator being like, somebody snuck in the house and planted pornography into my abode.
It also reminds me of somebody who's like a pervert secretly, but they reject, like, you know, like a senator who like hates gay people, but then they're gay or whatever. Like, you're like, you have to abolish pornography, but then they're like a total fiend.
You found these magazines in my abode beside my commode? Somebody must have planted them.
I can't imagine.
I do declare. Well, certainly these magazines have nothing to do with moi.
With little me.
I'm from Alabama. We don't mess with that funny stuff down here.
I'm an Alabama sweetie. So I thought that it was real talk, that there were pictures of him everywhere.
Yes.
But then I thought he was joking, being like, why are pictures of dudes' butts everywhere?
Right. Yeah, I don't think so.
Oh, my God.
So while that's going on in the house,
God,
Dathan's in the crawl space trying to find his cat.
That makes everything more tragic.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there's something wrong with this man.
That like really unlocks just like a part of it. It's not just that he's obsessed with Dathan. He's like some weird deviant.
Yeah.
Not that dudes' butts are deviant, but like to have like pictures of them everywhere, like that's really weird.
Well, Dathan finds out under the house in the crawl space.
I knew that was a deviant thing, but I'm just saying, like, now it makes me think about him holding Josh for a while and like all the horrible abuse that probably went down.
Oh, yeah. I think that this book, at a certain point, this book turns from being just creepy into stomach turning.
Mm-hmm.
Because I really.
Well, yeah, that whole.
Yes. There's
like the butts thing is a weird detail that kind of like solidifies it. I know it sounds funny, but like for real though.
Yeah, the butts thing, I know. It's all fun and game.
Until you have pictures of dudes' butts everywhere.
It's all fun and game. Until the butt thing happens. Completely agree. So Dathan finds basically a nest under the house where the guy had like a sleeping bag that he was lying on under there so that he could just like, I literally picture him just like lying flat on his back and looking straight up at just floorboards. And he's under Dathan's room. There are dead animals under there. There's cat food there, but it's a different kind from what Dathan and his mom used to get for the cat because, well, the guy used to, I guess, feed the cat, possibly lure him under the house.
Yeah.
Maybe in the hopes that Dathan would come to try to find the cat.
Oh, God, William. You're right.
Yeah, that's what it is. And a shitload of dead animals.
Ton of dead
animals.
And like all like smooshed together like a chimera, he says.
Yeah.
Ugh.
So essentially, the creepy guy lived under the house
mm-hmm.
and stared up at the floorboards under Dathan's bed. And then once Dathan and his mom moved out, leaving some of their stuff behind,
yeah.
he upgraded, moved into the house, yeah. unpacked those boxes, put Dathan's clothes up in the closet, and hung a bunch of pictures of him all over the house.
And dude's butts. Yeah.
Yeah. And not only that, as they're running away from the house,
yeah.
Josh starts gasping, and he's like,
yeah.
He took my picture.
Yeah. Ugh.
So he's
God,
marked.
God, it's so scary.
As well now. It's also pointed out more in the novel than in the original stories
uh-huh.
that Josh and Dathan look a lot alike.
Oh, I kind of forgot about that.
I know. It's a weird angle of it that feels exclusively for foreshadowing.
Yeah.
So it doesn't register because you're like, this is like really in my face. Like,
yeah.
No one talks like this.
Yeah.
Where they're just like, boy, you're right, Cassandra.
Maybe that's the purpose of the Mrs. Maggie chapter.
The purpose of the Mrs. Maggie chapter is that, one, she's...
Which is the next chapter, so
she's
good timing.
She's a vehicle to get to a scary story.
Mm-hmm.
It's
maps.
Yeah, it's maps. To where it's just like, okay, well, this is an old woman, and mm-hmm. and she's confusing. Mm-hmm. They later, he's like, as an adult, I realized she had Alzheimer's. Mm-hmm. At the time, it was just funny to me and Josh that she called us by the wrong name. Mm-hmm. You find out that she has her own tragic story.
Mm-hmm.
I think that she is really just there as a vehicle for horror.
Right.
Because she is eventually murdered.
Right.
She thinks that her husband came home.
Right.
Her husband is long dead.
Mm-hmm.
The person who came home. Mm-hmm. Is Scary Man
mm-hmm.
because he was watching the kids in the woods, and he probably realized that since she can usually watch them in the woods, her house would be a great vantage point. So he breaks in, he kills
didn't
her.
Get that either?
Yeah. Wow, Chris. These are all things that I'm not like. This is my fan theory. I feel like
I
this
know.
Is all like real, like just like in the print. Anyway, they also as they're like. Maps is my least favorite chapter, but there are a couple cool moments. The one that I like in particular is that Josh and Dathan are paddling around on their makeshift raft. And
I just realized I thought something so stupid.
What?
Real quick. I was just like, well, that doesn't make sense, but whatever, I'll move on. When she said Tom's home, I thought she had the dead body of Tom in there the whole time.
Oh.
And then that was the body that they brought out.
No, that was her body they brought out.
Okay. You're right. I was like, well, that's why
you,
I was like,
you
it's
just
so
thought there was like a totally disconnected murder.
That's
that
why I said that. In the beginning, I was like, it doesn't have anything to do with anything.
Well, but it doesn't have
it
anything.
Still
to do
kinda
with anything.
It still kind of doesn't, but it has more.
Yeah. I thought you were talking about the fact that it's just like she's just there. She's just like a thing that's also happening.
Nope. It was just a totally separate story to me. So that's why I was like, oh, that's the purpose of that, because she says that they look like her son. So it's driving home the point
right.
that they look alike. So right. that's the purpose. I didn't think the guy had anything
yeah.
to do with it.
Oops. Sorry, Raj.
I don't know what's wrong with me.
Well, I'm happy that I can help.
Yeah, I am too. Jesus.
This book's
even better than I thought.
I was about
now.
To say, does this make it better?
Yes.
Because you recommended it before, but all these pieces I felt are integral to the story.
I'm embarrassed.
Because there are a lot of twists and turns, and there's so much layering going on.
I'm very embarrassed. I'm not going to lie.
It's okay. I think we all forgive you.
I feel ashamed.
But the thing that I really
yes, I like it much
chapter,
better.
Is that Josh and Dathan are on their raft, and they think they hear something in the woods, and they're like, hello?
Yeah.
Hello? And as they continue to like hear nothing, they mm-hmm. start being like, hello?
Oh, yeah.
Hello?
Yeah, they're like having fun. Yeah.
And then very quietly they hear, hello.
Oh, God.
And they... What the fuck? And they start scrambling. And they're starting to try... They're like, what the fuck? Okay, so there actually is someone there. And they're watching. And they try to get
and
out.
They
and they're trying to
the
run away.
That they were working on.
Yes. And they can hear the footsteps of the person mm-hmm. running along the bank. And they're like, oh my God, we got to get away from him.
Yeah.
I love that moment.
Yeah,
I think I
great.
Stole that moment without realizing it.
Uh-huh.
I think that moment genuinely inspired me for some things that I have written.
Mm-hmm.
And I think maybe it ended up in Illuminati.
Mm-hmm.
I think maybe it did. Yes, when? It did. There's a moment where you are mm-hmm. in Ireland in a hotel room.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
And then somebody pounds on the door.
Yeah,
and you're like, hello?
Oh, yeah.
And then a voice whispers. I forgot what it said. It was an arbitrary thing it said.
I thought you were talking about the running.
The what?
I thought you were talking about the running.
No, the okay. whisper. Yeah. I love that, like,
yes.
you can't see them. And you start to be like, okay, so we're fine. There's no one there.
Yeah.
Hello. I love that.
Ugh.
Yeah, but that's all that Maps has for me that mm-hmm. really, really works.
Yeah.
Screens.
Mm-hmm.
We really only have two more pieces, mm-hmm. technically. Screens takes place years and years later.
Yeah.
Dathan and Josh are, they have not been friends for a few years. They just kind of grew apart.
Mm-hmm.
And Dathan starts
But after that, it was after they went to the house and the guy took a picture of Josh and everything. They kind of like were both like, meh.
Yeah. And so they just drifted apart and they don't talk at all.
Yeah. But one of those things where you are trying to forget about the experience. So you kind of drift away from the person who you shared that experience with.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
It makes it more distant and less real.
Yeah, you don't have to confront
mm-hmm.
it.
Mm-hmm.
So Dathan runs into Josh's sister,
mm-hmm.
and they have kind of like a meet cute,
mm-hmm.
and obviously are into each other, and they decide to go on a date together to go to the movies.
Yeah.
Now this
at
one,
the dirt theater. Yeah.
Now this one sticks in my memory.
Mm-hmm.
The rest of them, I think, are really cool. Mm-hmm. This one in particular, rereading it again, I'm not even sure why it's the thing that I call to mind as mm-hmm. much as I do.
Yeah.
For me, this is like the height of what PenPal does.
Yeah.
Where they go to he's walking to the theater. He mm-hmm. had to sneak out of his house.
Mm-hmm.
A car pulls up behind him.
Yeah.
And is being like a real spookster wanting to know everybody.
Big time.
And he's staring at them. He's like, what do you want?
Yeah.
And then they just drive around him.
Yeah.
And he's like, what the fuck was that?
That's the thing. Also, this guy's been doing this for 10 years at this point because the kid, Dathan, sends off the balloon like when he's 5, and then he's 15 now.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. It's been going on for a decade.
Yeah.
So he goes to the movies. He meets up with the sister. She's always cagey whenever he brings up Josh.
Mm-hmm.
and then... They leave the theater. Oh, well, first I think he sits in the theater and a man sits down next to him.
Yes.
And he's like, what the fuck?
Mm-hmm.
What is this guy's deal?
Totally.
And so he like scooches away or something. Or like the man gets up and I forget how that corrects
itself. I know. I don't remember now. Yeah. Now either. Yeah.
I don't remember. But then, the guy's gone and he meets up with the girl.
Yeah.
And then after the movie, they're walking around outside and she's going to give him a ride back.
Yeah.
And they trade phone numbers mm-hmm. and he's like, oh, I got to go pee.
Yeah.
It was like a weird thing to tell her, I feel like, at that moment. But he's like, I'm going to go run behind the
theater
and pee-pee.
There's no other way to get around it, though. I was thinking the same thing. It's all closed. Yeah. Like, why would he be walking away from her?
Exactly.
So you kind of have to.
So he like scuttles away mm-hmm. and he goes to pee and he hears an accident.
Mm-hmm.
And he runs back and she's on the ground. She's just been hit by a car and she is... Like her leg is broken, her arm is broken, and
like completely broken, like out of place.
Yeah,
yeah.
And he reaches in her pocket to call 911 mm-hmm. and stuff. He has a busted old phone.
Yeah, yeah. It won't receive pictures. It's like really messed up.
Yeah. And so he calls for an ambulance, and they come and they take her, and she admits to him later in the hospital when she's in a full body cast
mm-hmm.
that she has not seen Josh in mm-hmm. years because Josh ran away.
Yeah.
A few years ago, he just left a note on his pillow
mm-hmm.
and disappeared. And we know.
Vamola.
I know. We know what that means.
Yeah.
They don't mm-hmm. highlight that. Dathan Auerbach does not highlight that moment. He doesn't put a spotlight on note on a pillow.
Right.
He leaves that for us to realize mm-hmm. what it means. And I love
that
it.
I got.
Yeah. That I think is – that is one of those things where I'm like, this is a genius piece mm-hmm. of like kind of retconning
mm-hmm.
that this is like a methodology that this guy has. He's done this probably before and he's done it now with these two guys.
Mm-hmm.
Really incredible.
Totally.
Like chill down your spine. Oh my God, it happened to Josh.
Mm-hmm.
But he actually took him.
Yeah.
He didn't run away.
Yeah.
And so Dathan tries to stay up with, is her name Veronica?
Yes.
And like talk to her and stuff, but eventually he has to leave and mm-hmm. they start texting. And she's, they're texting and he's like, I can't wait to see him. I'm so sorry.
Yeah.
And they get to the point where now it's been a couple of weeks. She's mm-hmm. in the hospital. She does not want him to come see her.
Yeah. As soon as he left the hospital the last time he saw her, she texts him and is like, don't come here anymore. I don't want you to see me like this.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then she says she loves him.
Yeah.
And he says, I love you too.
Mm-hmm.
And then the oopsie.
Yeah. Mega oopsie.
He tells his mom that he wants to go see her.
Mm-hmm.
And this is like a moment that is both amazing and a moment of like, mm-hmm.
I know, how could you possibly? Yeah, totally.
The mom goes, oh my God, you don't know?
Well, she starts losing it crying.
She died.
Yeah.
She died the next
day. How would he not know that?
She died the next day.
Yeah.
How would he not know that? How would she know that and he didn't know that?
That's what I'm saying. It doesn't make any sense.
Why would she not talk to her son
about
something that...
I'm not sure what the mom's deal is. Her relationships, I don't understand.
No. And they talk about, like, at the end, he's like, I had a falling out with her.
Right.
Like, mm-hmm. we don't really talk anymore.
Yeah.
And it sounds like she spent a lot of this time trying to protect him.
Right.
And I get that. You put up a big, strong mm-hmm. shield, and it doesn't let anything through, but it's in the name of protecting your kid.
Yeah.
But even he can't get through, so you fall apart.
I also just don't understand why, like... Okay, here's something that... Now I'm embarrassed because there's so many things that I didn't
there's
get.
There's a lot of stuff in this book.
Okay, so I'm zooming ahead a little bit because I'm talking about the mom. The very last chapter where they find Josh and the killer in the grave.
Yeah.
Is that Josh's dad who found them?
I think so, yeah.
Because yeah. they refer to it as being his son, but then he kind of like... Also, I don't know how to explain it, but like also talks about his parents almost in a way that's disconnected from the father.
Oh, really?
I don't know how to explain it. But anyway, my main question is, why did he call the mom, like Dathan's mom? I know that he had a picture, like Josh had a picture of Dathan pinned to his right. shirt, which is fucked up. But I don't get why the like Josh's dad called Dathan's mom when he found dead bodies.
I think that there was some understanding of what had been going on, mm-hmm. what had been happening to Dathan all mm-hmm. his life.
Mm-hmm.
She kept it from Dathan.
Right.
But I don't think it was any secret what was happening to her right. family.
Uh-huh.
So I think that Josh's parents were well aware that mm-hmm. she and her son
okay.
had been being stalked.
Okay.
And when he sees what mm-hmm. he buried,
yeah.
basically, and we'll get to it.
Yeah, yeah.
And he realizes, oh my God, mm-hmm. this is the stalker.
Yeah.
And he killed my son because he thought that my son
mm-hmm.
was your son.
Mm-hmm.
He calls her.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's it.
Do you think he thinks that Josh is Dathan?
No, I think that
he's
out of his head.
Yeah.
I think that he like, don't they also talk about how like he and the mom lost their minds basically after that? Two dead children.
I mean the killer thinks
oh,
that
did
Josh
the killer,
is Dathan?
No, I think
okay.
that he was
yeah.
grooming
yes.
Josh okay. to be a better
right.
to be almost as good as the real thing.
Right.
Exactly. Knowing that he can't have Dathan.
Exactly. Okay, yeah. I was just making sure.
No,
I'm questioning everything.
I know. But we find out that now the mom's mm-hmm. like, no, she died.
Yeah.
We learn that her parents,
mm-hmm.
her and Josh's parents didn't cancel the phone bill because they were
right.
like, bereaved. They,
right.
were, they were dealing with everything that was happening. And then later found out that that line was costing a shitload of money
mm-hmm.
because whoever had the phone
mm-hmm.
was constantly sending pictures
yeah.
to Dathan.
Right.
But we know he couldn't receive them.
Right.
But,
so we don't know what the pictures were.
And that is a real
mm-hmm.
spine-tingling kind mm-hmm. of thing too because
oh, totally.
The killer, the weirdo,
yeah.
the bad potato,
yeah.
he doesn't know necessarily that Dathan's phone can't
right.
accept pictures, right?
Right, completely.
So he thinks that maybe Dathan is getting the pictures,
yeah.
is well aware that he's talking to the crazy guy.
Yes.
And is saying I love you to him.
Oh, man, I didn't connect those dots.
Yeah, right?
Yeah, completely.
So
yeah.
what must that guy be thinking now? Like,
yeah,
oh, it's working.
I didn't
working.
Think about what the guy's thinking.
It's
yeah.
working.
God.
Yeah.
Ugh. Yeah.
So the final chapter is largely what we talked about. And this is, I think, the weakest one,
uh-huh.
which is disappointing. Just because two things, there are no real answers, and I feel like it's a little convoluted.
Yeah.
Basically, the killer paid Josh's dad, who
right.
worked in construction but
right.
was looking for jobs,
mm-hmm.
he just paid him cash
mm-hmm.
to dig holes in the woods.
yeah.
And then come back someday and refill the holes.
Right.
And in between, he put a coffin in the ground and dragged
yeah.
Josh and himself in the coffin.
Right.
And then the dad came back and refilled the holes without ever looking at anything.
Right.
I feel like you would notice that.
Yeah.
And killed them.
Yeah.
But here's the weird thing.
Yeah.
I mean, if we can't
but I
refer
gotcha.
To that as the weird thing.
Right.
Josh and Bad Potato, BP,
mm-hmm.
are in the coffin and... BP,
mm-hmm.
Josh bit his neck.
Yeah.
And he bled out.
Right.
So he died there on the spot, basically.
Right.
Like, Josh dug in and bit his jugular, I guess.
Uh-huh.
And then BP dies with a smile on his face because he
right.
gets to be...
So creepy.
He gets to be with the object of his desire for
right.
all, forever.
Yeah, totally.
And Josh is buried alive.
Right.
And when they open it, his face is like frozen
yeah.
in a rictus,
mm-hmm.
silent, like whale.
Oh, God. It's so awful.
Wow.
And he's wearing clothes that are too small for him.
Yeah.
And his hair has dyed.
Yeah, because he's a little boy.
Yeah.
He's made to dress like in the clothes that Dathan had.
Right.
When he was a kid, the clothes that he left behind at the house.
Oh, it's so horrible.
It is so fucked up.
Yeah.
It's so overload of fucked up that, like, I can't really wrap my head around
completely.
How I feel about it.
I was like,
It's nauseating, but it's like my brain has a block on it to prevent me from really, like, being like...
Losing your mind.
What? Yeah. Maybe it's also that I do think that it's convoluted.
Yeah, it is.
It's very kind of clunky to me. Mm-hmm. This is like if they can get this movie going, this is a big opportunity for a rewrite.
Yeah.
But I do think that it's interesting to think that the guy essentially gets away with it.
Right.
Like, I don't know if there's a better way
and
for the story to end.
And you don't ever find out, like, what his deal is, really.
Nope.
Like... Because how did he even find out, you know, Dathan's address and stuff? Because the address was for the school.
Well, he went there and took pictures of him, probably followed him
home. Yeah, I guess so. But, like, just, like, what is his deal?
I don't know. I love, though, that this whole thing really hinges on classroom of students full of optimism, running outside to let their balloon things go to find a pen pal.
Yep.
And any one of them could have gotten picked.
Right.
But his balloon...
Right, which is what the book kind of ends with.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Just like chance.
It has like nothing to do with me.
Yeah, if he had let it go like 5 feet to the left, like everything could have been fine.
Yeah.
Could have. Maybe wouldn't be, but
yeah,
it could
maybe
have.
It wouldn't be, but it could have. Really, really weird.
Yeah.
Really weird and very intense and so unique.
Totally. Yeah.
Yeah, I really...
I was just about to say, you know, talking about it now, I like it even more than when I first read it. I think I know why.
Yeah, because you'd know a whole lot more.
Yeah.
You were missing a solid chunk of the story.
Sure was, Willie.
Yeah, real cool.
Yeah, it was great.
This is a book that is completely, like, original and unlike anything else I've ever read before.
Absolutely, yeah.
I'm really glad that we got to talk about it on this show.
Yeah, me too. I'm so glad that we did it.
Yeah.
I was like, you had told me about it a long time ago, and I was always like, yeah, we'll read someday. Even when we picked it, I was like, okay, yeah, it'll probably be good or whatever.
Right.
But yeah, like the whole backstory and the story itself has been really good and fun to talk about.
Absolutely. I really hope he does more. I hope he does more.
It doesn't sound like he will, though, right? I mean, it just doesn't seem like there's any indication. There's no indication that he won't, but...
Not in the past couple of years, but he was making references to, like, something good is coming.
Mm-hmm.
And we've had to do that.
Yeah.
Like, we've got even a project right now...
Yeah, true.
...that we can talk about, but there's no real reason to talk about it because it's not happening right now.
Right.
So it's like... You can either continually string people along and be like, something...
Yeah, it's like annoying.
Something good is on the way, or you can just be like, all right, I'm going to shut up until I've got something.
Yeah, totally.
And I kind of I hope that that's what he's doing. I hope he's working on something.
Yeah, me too.
I think that this is a really amazing first book.
Yeah, absolutely.
And especially to go back through and see how immediately he wrote it over the course of a month.
Yeah, that's nuts.
Unless it took prior planning.
Yeah.
Dathan Auerbach essentially sat down in September 2011 and wrote a book.
Yeah, that's awesome.
He just wrote it over the course of a month.
Yeah.
And within a year,
the twisted mind.
Yes, from the twisted mind of Dathan Auerbach. And a year later, it was a published novel.
Yeah.
Incredible.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Everybody, you know, this is one of those things where it's like, this is kind of goofy. But the immediacy of this makes this possible. Go to Facebook and look up 1,000 Vultures. It's literally 1,000 Vultures.
Mm-hmm.
If you enjoyed this book, just post on his page and be like, hey, I just read Pen Pal and it was great.
Totally. I mean, maybe that's part of why he wrote so fast, was response to it. Like, I could see that, like, would excite you and get you motivated and everything.
Absolutely.
So let's motivate a bitch.
Yeah.
And I'm sorry, I called him a bitch.
Yeah. We're sorry but you are a bitch.
Yeah.
well, this is actually, that's an interesting thing. This is one of those shows where it's like, we easily, like, happened with Patricia Cornwell. We posted about the show and then she replied to
us. Oh, yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Oh, no, I got to silence this. I'm sorry. Everything is happening very live right now. But, like, this is one of those shows that, like, we easily probably could post this and show him our show.
Yeah.
Now, I brought up some criticisms of it. I would hope that those are not things that would be insulting.
Because
I think that those have got to be outweighed by how glowing we've been about the book in general.
Yeah, totally. That was great.
But, like, knowing what it's like to be a person that's trying to produce something.
Yeah.
It's incredible whenever somebody is aware of it.
Oh, completely.
You know, and so like, I feel like it's been a couple of years. So like, I love this book, and I want to send some love this guy's way. So
yeah, totally.
1,000 Vultures. Mm-hmm. He's also got a Twitter account, but he doesn't really do anything on it. It doesn't seem. But like, yeah, if you guys have it in you, and if you liked this, please go tell him that you liked it. All too often we are entertained by stuff, but people are outside of our reach. You can't tell Robert Downey Jr. that you liked Iron Man. You know what I mean?
You can. I guess he probably has like Twitter or something, right?
Yeah, probably. And you can do that. And I bet a million people do
it. Yeah.
But
I know. I'm just
it's not as significant.
I'm just nitpicking.
I know.
I'm having my fun.
But yeah, go do that.
Yeah, totally.
And to that end, if you enjoyed this show, if you liked Book Club, Shmook Club, we're available on every possible podcast app, I believe. If there's somewhere that we're not, let me know and I'll put us there.
Yeah.
Please consider subscribing to us on YouTube, liking our video on YouTube, writing reviews of the show wherever you can on iTunes, whatever. That would be huge. We'd greatly appreciate that. We actually do have a new review.
Oh, cool.
That I wish we had done at the beginning, but maybe we do pull it up so we can just get it on the record here.
Sure.
I want to add it to the meeting's minutes.
Of course.
And if you want to talk to us about Pen Pal, about any books that you would like us to read in the future, any books that we've read in the past, we've got a pretty significant archive.
Yeah.
You can, of course, do all that stuff. We're very within reach.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can talk to us about it in 1 second.
You can talk to us on Twitter, Instagram, pretty much everywhere.
Yep. I'm at Chillin' Kristen.
I'm at Will Rogers 2000. You can also keep up to date with all of our productions by following at TalkBomb. Do you have that review?
Yes, I do. Cool. Did we already see Keen Observations' Marvelous Rapport?
I think we did.
I think we did now, too. Did. Yeah, yeah. Okay. So the title of this review is Incredible Banter and Awesome Reviews. I stumbled on this podcast and fell in love with listening. They don't take themselves that serious and come off pretentious like a lot of other shows. Will and Kristen do a great job of pointing out the highs and lows of the books. I can't recommend them enough. Please keep going. This is awesome. And that was from Angie 2180. So thank you so much, Angie. That's awesome.
Thank you so much.
Sweet. Oh, I'm glad I didn't see that.
Also, shout out to NOLA Book Club. Is it?
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh. Right? Yeah.
Is that the full name? I want to give
I think it's like NOLA Expressions Book Club, possibly.
You are 100% right.
Okay.
NOLA, as in New Orleans Expressions Book Club, has been sharing our show a lot.
Yeah.
And I really, really appreciate that.
So cool.
It is awesome. It's really cool.
I was so pleasantly surprised when like you found that and then when I got tagged in something and I was like, what?
Yeah.
And they were stoked to read Pen Pal. Wait, so, yeah.
Is her name her name was Angelique in that review?
Angie. So, maybe it's her.
I believe that is her.
Oh, cool.
So, shout out to you, Angelique White Miller from NOLA Expressions Book Club.
Yeah, check out her account.
Absolutely.
On Instagram.
And thank you so much for doing that. It was exciting.
Oh, completely. She put up a screenshot of like our iTunes thing and was talking about listening to it, so it was great.
So cool.
Yeah.
And yeah, thank you guys so much for listening. We hope that you enjoyed the show.
Well,
whether you're listening or watching or what,
do you want to talk about the next book?
Oh my god, that's I'm sorry, I'm getting way ahead of myself.
Yeah. Okay, so before we go, what we are reading next time is Whatever Happened to Baby Jane. So there's a show on FX right now called Feud, about the feud between Betty Davis and Joan Crawford, who were really hot movie stars in like the mid 1900s, basically, like 50s and up. I'm not sure what
that makes it sound like a jillion years ago.
I know when I said that the mid 1900s, I just thought the same thing. I don't know why I described it that way. But so they
you can still say 60s.
I know. I don't know why I did that. I say weird things. I don't know. What did I say earlier today? Oh, I was talking about Honey Boo Boo and I called her Alana.
Yeah, that was weird. You're like, I'm like Alana.
Because I was like squishing my stomach.
I had no idea what you were talking about.
And last week I called MGM Metro Goldwyn Mayer.
Yeah, you're weird.
I know. I don't.
You're like dad.
Yeah.
His dad would just like, he'd be like, where are we going, stopping, chap? He'd be like, what are you talking about? And it would turn out to be ShopRite. It's not even Stop and Shop, where you just be like, what are you saying?
What? I'm just filling the hole he left, I guess. And I'm proud to do it, so fuck you.
Yes.
So yeah, we're gonna read Whatever Happened to Baby Jane, because the show Feud on FX, I watched it today. First of all, it's amazing. And it's Jessica Lange and Susan Sarandon starring as Joan Crawford and Betty Davis, respectively.
Cool.
And it's about them being on the set of Whatever Happened to Baby Jane and how they basically like hated each other's guts. And it was a whole thing. I don't know that much about their feud. I know that One of them was nominated for an Oscar for the movie, and then I think the other one boycotted the Oscars, made a big stink about it because weren't nominated.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it's. I mean, the book. I mean, the movie so far, or sorry, the show so far is really good.
Yeah,
it's by Ryan Murphy. It's like I know, but no, it's real. Like you know this. Did you watch American Crime Story?
No.
Oh, that was amazing too. So the same way that American Crime Story was totally amazing and different from American Horror Story and everything, this is also just like its own thing.
I don't like Ryan Murphy shows.
It's so good. No, you should give American Horror Story a shot. I mean, Crime Story.
I would be willing to try it. I just didn't. That one I would have watched. I just didn't get around to it. It's this one great. I would watch.
This is great.
I like Susan
too.
Sarandon and Jessica Lange.
They're so good.
This I'm very excited because I'm aware of whatever happened to Baby Jane as being like a really cult horror film.
Yeah, totally.
And one of the few entries in a little-known subgenre of horror called the Grand Dame Gunal.
I've never heard of that.
We'll talk about it. I almost did.
Cool.
Late last year, I was actively developing a new podcast because I found out about the subgenre Grand Dame Gunal.
I was say, it also might be Grand Dame.
Grand Gunal.
I kind of, I don't know.
I guess maybe it's better to say it with every flourish possible.
Totally. But I know talking about a Grand Dame is a thing.
Oh, okay.
And pronouncing it that way.
Okay, well then there you go. It's Grand Dame Gunal.
I guess, yeah.
So I'm very excited to read the book.
Have you seen this movie?
No, but I will now.
Okay, because I saw it, I mean, I don't even know how long ago. I think I was like a teenager or something.
Yeah.
So I don't really, I remember key things that a lot of people know about it and everything. I had no idea that it was a book until I watched Feud today. And apparently Joan Crawford was looking for movies to pitch that would be a vehicle for herself and just wanted, she sent like her assistant whose name is Mamacita, which is amazing, to the library to just get like any books about women.
Cool.
And she came back with a bunch, including Whatever Happened to Baby Jane. And I was like, really?
That's cool.
Yeah.
That's a cool backstory.
Totally. So I'm going to read the description to you guys right now.
Cool.
So it's the chilling novel that inspired the iconic film. The neighbors all whisper about the two sisters who live on the hill. It's Blanche Hudson who lives in that house, you know. The Blanche Hudson, who starred in big Hollywood films all those years ago. Such a shame her career ended so early, all because of that accident. They say it was her sister, Jane, who did it. That she crashed the car because she was drunk. They say that's why she looks after Blanche now, because of the guilt. That's what they say, at least.
Wow.
Nobody remembers that Jane was once a star herself. A fixture of early vaudeville, Baby Jane Hudson performed her song and dance routines for adoring crowds until a move to Hollywood thrust her sister into the spotlight. Even now, years later, Jane dreams of reviving her act. But as the lines begin to blur between fantasy and reality, past resentments become dangerous, and the sisters' long-kept secrets threaten to destroy them.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
Yeah, totally.
I'm very excited for this.
Yeah, me too. I had no idea that it was a book.
One of my favorite things to do on the show.
As a grand dame.
Yeah, as a grand dame, is to read a book that I didn't know had inspired a very famous horror film.
Yeah.
I think we've only really gotten to do it with Psycho, but I've been looking for others.
Totally.
And this fits the bill 100%.
Oh, completely.
I'm very excited for this.
And I also, even though there's no real indication that it's anything like it, I do kind of love 1960s-ish or whenever it is horror,
yeah.
Like Rosemary's Baby and Psycho, I guess. So, yeah. Like, I'm stoked.
Cool.
Yeah.
Awesome. So, guys, read through that book so that we can talk about it in 2 weeks.
Yes.
If you need to pick up a copy, go to talkbomb.com/schmook. We will have a link there that will bring you right to Whatever Happened to Baby Jane. And if you buy it through that link, you will be supporting this show.
Yeah.
It will not add a cent to your checkout price, but if you use that link, they'll know that it was because of us.
Yeah.
And Amazon will pay us.
Yeah, totally.
So please consider supporting the show that
please.
Way. We had, at the very least, my brother-in-law, Michael Palmer, did that with this very book.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, totally.
So please consider it doing it for the next book. Is there anything else that
no.
we haven't covered that you want to get on the...
No, I don't think so.
On the record, on the minutes?
I think that's it.
Awesome. Well, thank you guys so much for listening. I really enjoyed this show.
Me too. This was great.
So please go forth, spread the good word.
Yeah.
And hey, just have a nice day.
You know what? Have a good one. Have a happy and a healthy.
Because we'll see you again.
Mm-hmm.
But until then, good talk, gang.
Meeting adjourned.
You know, they say that one of our presidents was a peanut farmer. Which one was it?
Carver.
That's right.
Yeah.
He carved out those peanuts. That's why, you
what
know.
What the hell made you think of that?
I don't know. I was trying to think of something to ask you. Yeah, you know, they say that, like, you know, like people with the last name Smith, it's usually because, like, their family had, like, a blacksmith in it mm-hmm. at some point in the back. I bet Carver was, they had to carve out a good peanut patch. Jim, wait.
A peanut patch.
Wait, it was Carter.
Yeah, you're right. Carter. Yeah. Whoops.
My Jimmy Carter fan theory has just been busted.
Got all fucked up.
Live on the internet. So he's a liar. It had nothing to do with carving out a peanut patch.
Yeah. No, it's about carting peanuts.
Oh, you're right. Carting peanuts to the village.
To and from the village. From the peanut patch to the village.
Penny peanuts. Peanut for a penny.
A penny of peanuts actually probably a pretty steep price. That's also alliteration.
10 peanuts a penny.
That's pretty good.
Put it in your peanut pouch. Everyone used to have when Jimmy Carter was a boy.
You just reminded me, when I was a kid, I wanted to have like a coin pouch. Like a leather coin pouch.
Why?
Because I was so weird.
You were just an eccentric child?
Yeah, I loved like things of the past.
So
like
quaint.
I want like a leather coin pouch. I was like cinched, which is like woven leather, you know.
That sucks.
I know.
I remember I had a wax seal. I hate coins so much.
Oh, me too. They're so annoying.
Yes, I remember you had a wax seal. All right. Let me just listen to this audio real quick and then we'll get started.
Okay.
Hey guys, do you like TalkBomb? We could really use your support. Please go to patreon.com/TalkBomb where you can donate to us monthly. In doing so, you will get for yourself a bunch of bonus shows just as a thank you.
You can also find us on all social media accounts under the username TalkBomb. So that's Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Snapchat. Following us online is a great way for you to stay up to date on what we're working on for TalkBomb.
One of the best things you can do for our network is to review this show on iTunes, Stitcher, or whatever platform you listen to us on. Positive reviews help us grow and help new listeners find us.
But more than anything, thank you for listening to the show. We hope you enjoyed it, and we'll see you at TalkBomb.com.